prayer that, God, can I be your friend? And God, can you be my friend? I read a story somewhere in the 17th century over a guy who was called Oliver Cromwell, who was a lieutenant in England those days. And he sentenced one soldier to be hanged because of some various crimes. And this soldier was to be sentenced by hanging. He was to be hanged. And those days, they used to ring a bell. There was a curfew bell that was rung in the evening. The moment the curfew bell is rung, if you are to be hanged, there you are. But this one morning, or this one evening, the bell did not ring. And people are wondering what happened. But in that place, the fiancé of this soldier cried up to where the bell was, to the bell fly, and got hold of the crapper that rings the bell. And when they tried to ring the bell, it couldn't. And when they found out, and there she was summoned by Oliver Cromwell. And crying, what she did, she showed him the bruised and the wounded hands that had a lot of blood because of where she was trying to hold and the pressure on the cradle. And from that, Oliver Cromwell was so much touched that he said, your lover will not die because of your sacrifice. And that evening, the curfew bell didn't ring. Why? It's because there was a friend who was so willing to sacrifice all for his friends. Praise the Lord. And do you know that what God did for us? And that's what God expects us to do for your friends, to sacrifice. Barnas, if you will. And we need to grow in this fellowship with our Lord. I was reading the bulletin this morning, and I know you have this story of this guy, Mark Donald, who has written the book, Ordering Your Private World. I have read a number of his books. And he talks about this story when he bought this piece of land. It is in your bulletin. And they wanted to build their house, and they had to clear some blocks of stones. And as they removed the big boulders, it was easy removing the big boulders. But as they removed the big boulders, there are some smaller locks, and they were many. And as they were removing the smaller locks, they realized there were some small pebbles. And it was a lot of work trying to remove the small pebbles until they got the soil to plant the grass. In a friendship with the Lord, it is the same. When we got saved, that God removed the big boulders out of our lives. But then from there is work for us to do, to be able to maintain and sustain this friendship. This morning I'm asking, are you afraid of God? Are you afraid of God? Are you willing to pay the cost of this fellowship? Praise the Lord. The Bible has so many scriptures. Walk with me a number of them before I get into my message. I want to talk about being a friend. And I'll look at understanding this fellowship. What does it mean? Then I'll look at some of the results or the benefit, about five of them or four of them, the benefit or the result of being afraid of God. Then I'll look at some of the hindrance. What is the hindrance? What hinders us from growing in this friendship with our God? And then finally look at the call unto being afraid of God. What do we need to do? In the Bible, in Exodus chapter 33, verse 11, the Bible says about Moses. So the Lord spoke to Moses face to face, as a man speaks to who? To his friends. And then he says, and he would return to the camp. But his servant Joshua, the son of Nun, or Nun, a young man, did not depart from the tabernacle. You know, Moses would go to where God is, and they would speak face to face as a friend. But Joshua would remain in the tabernacle. I refuse to remain in the tent. Amen. When people are going to talk to God face to face, I would better be there. Hello? Does God speak to you face to face? Would you hear God speaking to you? Or do you start imagining, God, is it you? Or? God spoke face to face with Moses as a friend. In James chapter 2 verse 23, it refers to Abraham. And I love the story. Abraham, the friend of God. And it so happened, just as the scripture says, Abraham believed God, and God counted him as righteous because of his faith. He was even called what? The friend of God. And I want to explain briefly this story of Abraham. It was obedience and faith. Sorry, I am the one who put that, explain the background of Abraham and obedience. It was meant to be for me. I meant to do the explanation. Hallelujah. And if you go with me, maybe not right now, the book of Genesis chapter 22 from verse 6 up to verse 13. This is where we get the story of Abraham. Why Abraham was counted righteous. Why Abraham was called a friend of God. Why did God bother even to call him a friend? And the story goes, Abraham is called by God and told, walk with me to the mount of Moriah. Carry your son. And Abraham carried not only his son, he carried some two young men and carried a donkey, carried some firewood, and carried a knife. And they are walking to the mountain and he was given instructions. What I want to do is, I want you to go and sacrifice your son. A son that he got not in the early years when he thought he can get another. A son that he waited for. The son of promise. But there Abraham is told by God, this is what I want you to do. I don't think if it were you and me today, you would really listen to the, would you say, I don't think this is who you see Mungu ni chetania, pana. And you see, if you go back to the story of Abraham, it begins early enough when he was told to disconnect from his family. And he was told by God, I want you to go to a place. I'm the one telling you where. And last Wednesday, we were told by Pastor Jagger that if God told Abraham where he was going, Abraham could have decided which direction to go. Because if you are told by somebody we go to town, we meet town, some of you go through Ruaka bypass, others will go through Jiro. But God told Abraham, he didn't tell him where he is going. He was just told to wake up and some of us will want to know the direction. And in fact, we'll ask even for the GPS to the place where we are going. But for Abraham, God tells him, just rise up. And Abraham obeys God. He walks with his son. And the son is asking a number of questions. But I observed a few things as I was reading this story. That they went with two young men and a donkey. They reached a place. Then they left the two young men there. And they also left the donkey. Amen. Their places were by sons. Like that young men, a donkeys don't go. Hello? There are places that young men and donkeys don't go. Because they were left there. Bwana asifiwe. And then they also left the donkey there. Maybe these young men were not ready to what was happening. They were not friends of God. They were not ready to what was going to happen. Amen. And then he carries his son Isaac. And I also made an observation. He gave the son wood to carry. Amen. He didn't give him fire or knife to carry. Because he don't give fire and knife to children. We need to grow to whereby we become friends with God. We mature until God can give you the knife. Hello? We need to grow and mature until God can give you the fire for the sacrifice. But God moves with Abraham. And he tells Abraham is ready. He is ready, willing to sacrifice his son. And just before he does it, it's like somebody, an angel gets hold of his hand and tell him, don't do it. He had the voice telling him, do not harm your son. And from that point on, the Bible says, and God saw the faith in Abraham. And so Abraham, James quoting Genesis says, and so Abraham believed God, and God counted him as righteous because of his faith. He was called a friend of God. I like what Jesus says in John chapter 15, verse 15. Walk with me. These are scriptures that are related to us. And the Bible says, no longer do I call you servant, for a servant does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you what? Friends. For all the things that I have heard from my father, I have made known to you. Would you just give me from verse 13? Or that scripture. Verse 13. And please bring it from the Message Bible. Verse 13, 14, 15. Let's pick it where God is calling us friends. Why is he calling us friends? It says, this is the very best way to love. Put your life on the line for your friends. Amen. I don't know whether you're ready to put your life. Then verse 14. You are my friends when you do the things I command you. Verse 15. I no longer call you I'm no longer calling you servant, because servants don't even understand what their master is thinking and planning. No, I have named you friends because I have let you in on everything I have heard from my Father. This is Jesus calling us friends. He is telling us, you no longer need to be a slave. Slave no more, but become my friend. Amen. Become my friend by doing that which I command of you. And in Romans chapter 5 verse 10. Romans 5 verse 10. I like this because this is where we qualify to be friends. It says from the Message Bible, if when we were at our worst, we were put on friendly terms with God by the sacrifice, by the sacrificial death of his Son. Now that we are at our best, just think of how our lives will expand and deepen by means of his resurrection life. Very key words there. That we were put on flooded terms. When you and me were at our worst. In fact, another verse says, when we were enemies. When we were enemies. He made us his friends by sacrificing his Son. And how much more is he willing to deepen, to expand? But friends, it calls for you and me to do our part. Amen. If you have a friend, I know many of us, we have friends. If you have a friend that you never know, you never meet, you never talk, you never share anything, are you little friends? You cannot have a friend and that you're my friend. You never meet, you never talk. You know, friends. Hey, you see, when young men are courting a young man and a young lady, you don't need to encourage them to meet. True? Do you encourage them to meet? You don't need to encourage them to meet. They are looking and asking for any opportunity, any time, any space. They can talk address. Why? It's because they are friends. And that is what God is looking for. Unfortunately, we keep on encouraging you to become a friend of God. God help me. Amen. That every now and then I have to be encouraged. Mwithi, would you become a friend of God? This morning is my prayer that God can help me and help you to become friends of God. I want to pick it from, that was my introduction, by the way. I haven't begun preaching. Hello? I want to pick it from the book of John chapter 15. Because to me, this gives a true picture of what a friend needs to be and how to become friends. How can we understand this friendship? John chapter 15 verse 1 to 8. The Bible says, and I'll read it. I am the true vine. My Father is a gardener. He cut off every branch in me that bears no fruit. While every branch that does not bear fruit, he prunes so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me and I remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not remain in me, he is like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, it will be given you. This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourself to be my disciples. Praise the Lord. Understanding this fellowship. How can we understand this fellowship? God is calling us to a fellowship, and we need to understand what is he calling us to. Number one, fellowship with Jesus is a relationship. Hello? Tell your neighbor, fellowship with Jesus is a relationship. And the image of the vine in this scripture is a very good picture. Jesus is the vine. And those of us who are his followers, we and me and you, we are the branches. There must be a relationship with the vine. Otherwise, the Bible is telling us a branch will die. And this is where I want us to pick it from, that it is a relationship. Many of us as Christians, we focus on doing or not doing than being. God is not calling us to do or not to do. But you know, we think our Christianity, it is the doings and not doing. And so we come to church, we do, we serve in the church, we sing, we usher, we read, or we don't drink and we don't do this and we don't. We think that is what God is calling us to. God is calling us into being. Amen? Into being. A being element is our relationship with God. Friendship with Jesus is not head knowledge, but a heart experience. Amen? God is calling us to being, not doing. Tell your neighbor, it is being. It is becoming. Being a friend of God, it takes effort and practice. Think about this, the earthly relationship. How many of them would work without any effort on both parties? Even in marriages, if only one party is working on the friendship, it will crash. It will die. It's a two-way. It's a relationship. So friendship with Jesus is a relationship. And if we have to grow, we must work on this relationship. We must desire to talk to him, to listen to him, to concentrate. Amen? Not a one-off. There is no offs. You know, some of us, we work in shifts sometimes, or you have an off day. Our Monday is the off day for the pastors here. But this relationship has no off day. It is something that is continuum. Secondary, friendship with Jesus is a journey. Tell your neighbor, it is a journey. It begins when we experience the adoption as children. It grows as time goes on. Knowing a person takes time. It is a process. It is a journey of a lifetime. Being a friend with Jesus is a journey. Please, friends, it is a journey. And no matter where you are on this journey, there is always an opportunity to make a few steps in the process. Amen? Some of us in the journey, we may be follow. We may be at the beginning of this journey. Some of us, we may think we are the middle. Some of us, we may think we are coming close to that. No, no, no. Wherever I am, wherever you are in this journey, there is always an opportunity of growing in our friendship with Jesus. Amen? There is always, don't remain where you are. Don't remain stagnant. It is a journey. When I read this Bible, when I read John chapter 15, it amazes me. There are some very key things, some profound information that we get here. The Bible says, every branch that bears, amen, every branch that does what? Bears fruit. What does he do? He prunes. Pruning is a process of removing the unwanted things, branches. I'm an agriculture by profession. Oh, I have said so many things in this church where I did agriculture. So I know pruning. Pruning, you remove dead woods. You remove what is crowded. Amen? You remove what you don't want so that what is there can remain and give good fruits. When God is pruning you and me, he is telling you there is some business, there is some craft, you know, there is some stuff that I need to clear with. But I want to see what the Bible says. The Bible says it is a branch that bears fruit. He prunes. That it might bear more fruits. Amen. Then at the end of it, he says, then if you remain in me and if you abide and remain in me, you shall bear much. So it begins with fruit, more, and much. Are you seeing the process? That means you cannot remain stagnant. It is a journey. It is moving from fruit to more fruit to much fruit. It is a process. And God desires, as we work on this flagship, we are moving from one level to the other. No wonder we say, God, you are lifting us from one glory to the other glory. It is from one level to the other level. We cannot afford to remain stagnant in this flagship. It is a journey that we are walking. And thirdly, flagship with Jesus is a longing. It's a longing. It's like in courtship, like I said, with the young people. You don't need to encourage them to be meeting. For us to experience glowing fellowship, we must long to be with him. And Paul tells us in Philippians chapter 3 verse number 10 that I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his of sharing in his suffering, becoming like him in his death. Amen. It is a longing. It's something that you're longing. Something that you're looking forward to. Now, I know some of you have seen, you have seen a sign, keep distance. Is it true? Huh? Keep. If you go to a place, unfortunately, this is human beings. Even when you get a sign on the wall, wet paint, what do? We touch to make sure you know it is already. To see if it is wet. So when you are told keep distance, we don't keep distance. We want to know what is there. See, Dio? If you are told keep 200 feet from there, from here, we do not do it. We want to investigate. We want to, you know, we want to find out why are we keeping this distance. But let me say this. When it comes to God, imagine the Bible is telling us to get closer. And we are being encouraged because we are keeping a distance. When you don't need to keep distance, you keep distance. When you need to keep distance, you don't keep distance. May God help us. You know, think about Peter. When Jesus was to be crucified, we know the story of Peter. Peter followed from a distance. Do you know that? The Bible says he followed from a distance. And as he followed from a distance, many things happened. Because at a distance, somebody said he was among them. What did he say? No, I don't even know him. Three, the moment you keep a distance with God, you deny him. Hello? The moment we keep distance with God, we will become cold. For Peter, even when they were sitting at the fire, and I had made rise up and say, I also saw him. He said no, and even walked away. Why? It's because he was keeping distance. Friends, it is a journey. And we cannot afford to keep distance. We have to walk closer and walk closer with the Lord. Tell your neighbor, don't keep distance. And I challenge you today to do some distance deliberation. Ask yourself, how far are you? What distance are you keeping with God? Would you decide to get closer and closer to him? Praise the Lord. My time is running very, very fast. What are the results of being afraid of God? When we become afraid of God, there are some good, wonderful results. Amen. And I love this. And I want to become afraid of God. Amen. Because there are wonderful results, and we're picking it from the same scripture. The same scripture, John 15. Number one, there is fruitfulness. There is fruitfulness. Jesus has called us to be fruitful for his kingdom. Intimacy with Jesus. When we are intimate with him, we can bear fruit. John 15:5 says, I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me, I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Verse 16 says, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit that you will rush. Then the Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. Friends, our fruitfulness will be in direct proportion to our intimacy with Jesus. Amen. Sometimes it's so easy to think about being fruit. It's like being working hand and hand. But Jesus is telling us, if you remain in him, it is a matter of work, you know, remaining in him. When we remain in him, we will not work hard, we will not toil. You know, because it's a matter of abiding and remaining in him. When I'm thinking about this, I thought about the disciples. And many times, especially when at one point, Peter tells his friends, guys, me, I'm going back fishing. Then they just told me, we are also following you. And they went back fishing. And the whole night, they toiled. They got nothing. But Jesus appears to them somehow in the morning and asks them, guys, do you have fish for breakfast? You read one of the merchants says, do you have anything for breakfast? And they're saying, no. Then tells him, why don't you throw your net on the right side? And there they are. Why? They were doing on their own. But the moment Jesus appears, it changes the whole formula. Amen. Walking with Jesus bears fruit. We happen to bear fruit. Galatians chapter 5, verse 20 tells us, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Again, such there is no law. Do you want to grow in loving God? Do you want to have joy? Do you want to have patience? Do you want to enjoy peace? Do you want to enjoy kindness, goodness? Do you want to enjoy being faithful? Are you gentle? Are you praying? God, are you in self-control? Then the secret is being afraid with Jesus. Amen. And the fruit will come out naturally as we become friends with Jesus. Number two, or the second resource, is divine provision. Tell your neighbor, divine provision. Are you looking for anything from God? Divine provision. It is only when we are friends with Jesus. The Bible says in John chapter 15 verse 7, and please listen to this. And I like it from the best Bible. But if you make yourself at home with me, hello? If you make yourself at home with Jesus, and my words at home with in you, you can be sure. Tell your neighbor, you can be sure. That whatever you ask will be listened to and acted upon. Hello? That if you become a friend with Jesus, it does not matter what it is. There is divine provision. Whatever you ask. But then the condition is, you must be at home with me. Amen. And my words must be at home with you. In other words, we must deepen in our relationship. Sometimes we struggle asking of God. But you see, he is a strange God to you. You are asking from a strange God. Hello, how many of you would go to the father of your neighbor and ask him for school fees? Ate mzee, nimefukuza shule. Na nikuwa neighbor. Tenda kumuliza. Kwa nini? Siyo baba ya? Then imagine. Unaweza kuuliza, na si baba yako? Tunaenda kumuliza school fees. It's the same principle. We need, if we are asking anything of God, he's telling us, please friends, let me be home with you. Be home with me. Become my friend. I can listen. I can hear you. Be my friend. I want to be your friend. Then whatever you ask, it shall be listened to and even acted upon. It will be provided for you. Number three, joyful living. What a beautiful thing. Jesus promises a joyful living for those who are close with him. Verse 11, John chapter 15 verse 11. I have told you these things for a purpose, that my joy might be your joy, and your joy wholly mature. Many believers are not experiencing the fullness of, or the full joy that Jesus offers, because they have not learned to live in intimacy or to be friends with Jesus. It is costly. It involves surrender and obedience, but the result is indescribable joy. Amen. Do you want your joy to be complete? Become a friend. You see, when you meet with your friend, you laugh and joke. See, I'm a sequery. Usually when you are home with your friend, I'm telling you, there is laughter, there is joy. You never see two friends who are gloomy and, you know, sand on each other. They will not be two friends. The same applies when we become friends with God. We can walk with joy, or rather in joy, because we know him. Number four, and I like this, is we are able to enjoy full rights. We are no longer slaving. We no longer walk with ignorance. He reveals his secrets to us. He will let us know. And this is why we read John 15, verse 14, 15. You are my friend when you do things I command you. I no longer call you servants, because servants don't understand what their master is thinking or planning. No, I have named you friends, because I will let you in everything I have heard from my father. Friends, the Amplified Version says this: you are my friend if you keep on doing the things which I command you to do. I do not call you servants or slaves any longer. For the servants that not know what his master is doing or working out. But I have called you friends because I have made known to you everything I have heard from my father. I have revealed to you everything that I have learned from him. You know, when you become friends with Jesus, you earn the full rights of being a servant, or being a son, not a slave, not a servant, because he reveals to you, hello, he reveals to me what he's about to do. To Abraham, he revealed to him, amen, even when he was ready to strike Sodom and Gomorrah, he went to his servant. He went to his son. He went to Abraham and told him what he's going to do. God will reveal to you. Let me quickly mention about some of the hindrances to this fellowship. What are some of the hindrances to the fellowship with Jesus? Intimacy or fellowship with Jesus is a powerful thing. However, it has so many enemies. And the enemy does not want believers to be intimate with Jesus. And he'll use any means to keep us from experiencing this intimacy with Jesus. Number one is sin. Sin. All sins are from the world, and therefore, those who continue in sin cannot have fellowship or intimacy with Jesus. In 1 John chapter 5, chapter 2, verse 16, the Bible says, for everything in the world, the craving of sinful man, the lust of eyes and the boasting of what he has and does comes not from the Father, but from the world. In 1 John 1:6-7, the Bible says, if we claim to have fellowship with him, yet we walk in darkness, we lie and do not live by the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is right, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his son, purify us from all sin. Sin will always affect our relationship with Jesus. Sin will always deal a blow to our friendship with Jesus. And no wonder, when there is sin in our lives, we don't want to get closer to him. When you have an issue with your friend, you avoid them. See, query? Hello? Kwanza ukiwa na deni ya rafiki yako, na ulimpromise utamulipa, na siku zimeenda, ukimuona akitokea pande hile, unapiga kona, another street. Ama si kweli? Kama kuna kitu kati yako na rafiki yako, utaki kumuona. That is natural. The same happens to us. When you're walking in sin, we do not want even to get closer to him. We do not want to hear of him. But when we repent and confess of our sins, the Bible says he is faithful and just to forgive us, not only forgiving us, but to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That is how good and beautiful our God is. That doesn't matter what you have done. Amen. He has always his arms open. When the prodigal son, when he left his home and he went and did all that he did, he spent all that he had. When he was coming home, the father saw him from far off. The father did not tell him, I don't want to see you. Know what you have done? Where is that going to go in Yumba? The father opened his arms. Amen. And this young man comes crying. He comes running and kneels down to his father. He's saying, Father, treat me like one of your servants. I don't even deserve to be called your name or your own. And the father was not listening. Hello? He said, the father is saying, bring a robe. Bring a robe. Bring the best for my son. Why? It's because he has gone back to the father. Amen? Sin will always keep us away from this fellowship with our Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. The second hindrance is business. Tell your neighbor, business. Ebu ask them, are you very busy? Ask them, are you very busy? Imagine sometimes you are so even so busy for God. You become so busy for God. So busy for God. Our business will rob us time to become intimate with our God. And sometimes I think about we in Nairobi. God help us. Because people in Nairobi are busy. Hello, walk along the street of Nairobi. Everybody is walking very fast, learning. Even those who are going nowhere. From one corner to the other. Yani, hakuna pahali wanaenda. But because everybody is on spin, you are also on spin. We want to become so busy. And that business sometimes deny us this close fellowship with our God. That sometimes, you know, I have told God, God help me. We are busy. We are busy. It is true. And it's good to be busy. But I am uttering God, God help me. That I need to look at my priority right. Amen? Hello? Because all I need is my priorities right. Imagine what I have as God has given me and I become so busy for him. May God help us. When you become busy that your friend calls you, your friend will call you once, twice. Amen? And if you are not calling them back, what happens? That friendship. I had friends, by the way, and this is true. I had friends, very good friends. And I realized we are not enemies, but we haven't talked for 3-5 years. I don't even know where they are. And they were my. What happened? I became busy for them, or they became busy for. So at the KPI, there's one who called me and told me, happy many years. And I wondered, okay, happy many. It's because we haven't talked for a number of years. And he is my friend. But because he became busy, I became busy, that friendship was broken. That is what happens even in our walk with the Lord. When we become busy for God, that we are not available for home cell. Hello? Can I come a bit home here now? We are not available for the ladies' group meeting on Sundays because we are busy. We are not available for the men's moment because we are busy. We are not coming for the midweek service because we are busy. If you'd ask yourself what you are busy doing, you'd be shocked. Amen? Regardless of your excuse, that you have, I know you have beautiful, wonderful excuses. All of us. There is nobody who doesn't have one. But if you look deeply into it, you realize you are moving away from your friend Jesus. Amen? By becoming busy and busy. Amen? And the more busy you become, the more busy you end up being. And unfortunately, the moment you are busy, there is no time that you feel relaxed. You are always on the land. Barnabas, if you will. Business. The story in Luke chapter 10, we know the story of Martha and Mary. The Bible says, but Martha was distracted by all the preparation that he had to be made. She came and asked him, Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do the work by myself? Tell her to help me. Mother, mother, the Lord answered, you are worried and upset about many things. Tell your neighbor. Neighbor, you are worried and upset about many things. But one thing, only one thing is needed. Tell them, only one thing is needed. Only one thing is needed. Become a follower of Jesus. And that's what God is asking for us. Martha was so busy doing good things. By the way, none of us is busy doing bad things. They don't come to church. Hello? So they are not here. We are busy doing good. Good things. Good things. But God is saying only one thing is needful. Being a friend with Jesus. Number three, as I come to wind up, is other attractions. Tell your neighbor other attractions. Would you look at them in the eyes? Tell them what attracts you. What attracts you? I told some people yesterday that a statement that I got, that your habit determines your habitat. Amen? Tell them about your habit determines your habitat. It is very true. Your habit, if your habit is prayer, you'll be looking for a habitat of prayer. Amen? A fish, the habitat of fish is water. Or rather swimming. The habit of fish is swimming. So you always find a fish in there? Because that is the habit of a fish. Now what is your habit? What is your habit yourself? What attracts you? What are those attractions? You know, there are many things that are attracting us today. And they are beautiful. And please, friends, hear me well. I'm not saying they are bad things. They are good things. Amen? I'm looking for money. Hello? You too. Yes, I'm looking for this wealth. It is true, it's good. But do you know what? Sometimes it can be an attraction that you pull away from God. That means I need to be balanced in whatever I'm doing. There are pressures of this, or there are responsibilities that sometimes also come in. They become other tensions. In Luke chapter 18, we know the story of the seed. You know, the throw of the seed, who threw the seed. Some fell on some hard ground on the path, others on the thorns, others on the good soil. But there is one in verse 14, the seed that fell among the thorns stand for those who do what? Hear, but they go on their way. Then what happens to their life? They are shocked by life's worries. What are they? Riches and precious. So they do not mature. What is it? Is that we allow the riches and the pressures and the responsibilities and many things to become an attraction that attract us away from the Lord. Would you become afraid of God? Would you put away the attraction? Would you tell God, help me to balance that I don't have other attractions coming and taking you away? Friends, God is calling us to be friends. God calls you and me to be friends. In Matthew chapter 11, verse 20 to 30, the Bible says this, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart. You will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is right. In Mark chapter 3, verse 14, he appointed 12 designated them apostles, that they might be with him, that he might set them out to preach. Notice this. He is calling us as friends, not to do things, but he is calling us to be with him. Amen. Jesus calls us or longs to be with us, to enter into a little booth with him, into an intimacy with him. He is calling us to be with him. You know, it's a call that not just what you do, amen, not just who you are, but it is me and you. You know, come to me. Come to me. There's somebody who's saying, please, come to me. You who are weary and burdened, you know, and you have so many burdens. He's saying, I am your friend. I call you friends. Come to me. It calls for two things for us to be able to become friends of God. Number one, it calls for us to deny ourselves. It calls for us for deny the self, denying the self. If anyone comes after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for me will save it. God is calling us to deny. There is some sacrifice to be done. Amen. There is some surrendering to be done. For Abraham to become a friend of God, he was willing to sacrifice his son. Hello? For Moses to become a friend of God, he was willing to walk with God. In fact, Moses had to turn away the privilege of staying in the state house. Hello? He had the privilege of staying in the state house. And you see, in state house, you have everything you need. But for him to become afraid of God, he had to begin the journey of denying himself the privileges of being in the state house. You know, the education that he was to get. He got it yet, but he had to say no to that which was not of God. And for us, friends, it calls for us to deny. Are there things that you're telling God, I need to deny myself? Secondly, it calls for us to follow and abide in him. Come follow me. Jesus said, I'll make you fishers of men. You know, in our walk with the Lord, it is not difficult to know what we ought to do, but it's always difficult to follow in obedience. Verse 15, verse 4. Remain in me, I'll remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can it bear fruit unless you remain in me. You know, it is an intentional commitment to abide, to remain in the Lord. It means we must be willing to follow. We must be willing to abide. We must cling unto Jesus. Hello? We must cling to him. We must stay with him. We must be willing to follow him. We must be ready to say no to any other attraction that is pulling away us away from the Lord, no matter where you are in this journey. Friends, you can always take some step forward in the process. Intimacy with Jesus, it is not far off. It's a relationship that we can achieve as we long to be with him, as we allow the Spirit of God to help us to build it. We must consciously allow Jesus to be our friend. We must seek him. We must allow him. We should not be satisfied by just being saved.
Hello?
Let me say this. Please don't be satisfied with just salvation. Tell your neighbor, don't be satisfied with just salvation. Don't be content with keeping your relationship with God at a superficial level. Don't let this religion of faith become nothing more than religion. You know, sometimes we just want to be there. Priest, I don't just want to go to heaven. Hello? Can I say that again? See your two kweda biguni. Sababu biguni ni kuwako katusidio. You still are there anyway. So long as you are born again. Hata kama utasukuma na wegine wigwe baka dani. Uko na utaida tu. But I think in this world, I need to grow. I need to develop. I need to work with a friend called Jesus. And I need to know him. Amen? Like Paul said, I need to know him and the power of his selection that I can share in this fellowship. You know, I can share with his suffering. That I can share with him. That I can walk with him as a friend. That he can let me know. We can talk. Hello? I was telling some people yesterday, we had a guides meeting and I was telling some men that sometimes somebody said that sometimes we have visions against God, especially we, the Pentecostal. Visions against God. So when you are praying, umekasirika na Mungu. Visions. You are raising your visions against? And against your friend. Now, surely, when you go to your friend, how do you approach your friend? Nimekwambia lazima unipatie. Yeah? Is that what you do to your friend? Then how do you go to God? Visions. Yeah? You are running from there. You are talking to God. You're telling God you must do it now. Surely. Let's decide to work with this friend. Amen? He's a friend. He is your friend. That's just the way you talk. You talk with Moses as a friend talk, you know, to one another. That we can ask of him. Praise the Lord. I want us to pray. I want us to stand. Hallelujah. He calls us as friends. Do you want to grow in this friendship with the Lord Jesus Christ? Or do you desire that you can grow in this friendship? Do you hear him calling you, Salah, you are my friend? Can you hear God saying, Anne, I am your friend? Is God speaking? I'm your friend. I want to become your friend. Are there things that you're saying, God, it is true. I'm so busy that I feel like I'm running away from you. God, I have so many attractions that are attracting me. I have no time. God, there is sin that is hindering me from enjoying a closer walk with you. Just as we sing, okay, let's sing this song, just a closer walk with thee. I don't know whether it's over there, maybe. Just a closer walk with thee. Jesus, that is my prayer. And for a minute, would you tell God, God, I want to become your friend. I just want to become your friend. Hello? Just want to become your friend. And you are here, you're not born again. Friend, the best you can do is just give your life to Jesus. He is your friend. He is longing, yearning for that friendship. He is saying, I call you by your name. I know you. I want to deepen my relationship with you. Hallelujah. Just a closer walk with thee. Jesus grant it.
Just a closer walk with thee. Grant it, Jesus, is my plea.
I am weak,
but thou art strong.
small, and then just go before the Lord. Tell us, tell God, just want to be your friend. Help me to walk close with Thee. Help me this walk. I want to become your friend, Lord. God is calling unto us today just to be friends. Father, in Jesus' name, what I call this morning, Lord, to walk close with You, Lord. Daily walking with You, dear. That is my desire, Lord. That is my desire, Lord. I long, dear Father, to walk with You, dear Father, that I can be Your friend, oh God. That I can't be Your friend. I want to be Your friend, oh dear Lord. And so I want to pray that, Lord, You will help me, God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Thank You, Lord. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, this morning, standing upon this altar, Lord, we acknowledge, dear Father, it is a higher calling, dear Father, and to us to be Your friends, Lord. That You can call us friend, dear Father. Lord, we can walk as Abraham walked, believing, trusting, dear Father. And it was counted for him righteous. He became Your friend, our Lord. Just like Moses would walk with You, dear Father. And this morning You have assured us, dear Lord, that You are not calling us servant, but dear Father, You are calling us friend. Because You let us know, dear Father, the sickness, dear Lord. This morning, oh God, when we were enemies with You, Father, You became friends. You called us our Father and our God. And to friendship, You gave Your very best, dear Father, for us. And I want to pray this morning, the Lord, You will help us, dear Father and our God. In this church, You help us to become friends with You, dear Lord. And I want to pray, dear Father, for each one of us. If there is that which is hindering us, dear Lord, from becoming friends with You, dear Lord, would You help us, dear Lord? Oh God, dear Father, help us. We repent, or we confess this morning of every sin that, dear Father, and our God, that is hindering us from being Your friends, our Lord. We want to repent, dear Father, of busy lifestyle, dear Lord, that is pulling us away from being Your friends, our Lord. God Almighty, we want to put away every other attraction, dear Lord, that is causing us, dear Father, not to be Your friends, our Lord, that we can deep our relationship with You, dear Lord. Oh God, I pray that You give us more time together with You, dear Lord. You give us the longing and the desire, Jehovah God, to be with You, dear Lord, and to walk with You, dear Father. Help us to make a choice today, Lord, a deliberate choice and a commitment, dear Lord, to walk daily with You, dear Father, in the name of Jesus. Father, I thank You and I give You praise. You're here this morning, you're not born again, you want to begin the journey of knowing Jesus as Lord and Savior, that He can be your friend. If you lift up your hands, I'll pray with you.